After 1391, after 1414, with the end of the Tortosa disputation, you have this unusual circumstance where there are Jews who adopted some level of Christianity, either an external veneer that was entirely hypocritical, or even, you know, being true believers and really entering the church and things like this. But suddenly they're injected into Iberian society and they have a lot of intrinsic advantages. They have a very, very high level of literacy. They are very well skilled with numbers, hence numeracy. They are overwhelmingly urban, so they have a lot of advantages of understanding the nature of the corridors of power and so on. And they're educated. And all of a sudden, by becoming Christian, whether, you know, by force or by choice, they suddenly have access to everything that was denied them when they were Jews. And they are, many of them, still remaining well in touch with their Jewish communities. Those who, of course, were forcibly converted often, you know, maintained a kosher diet, observed the Sabbath, taught their children in Jewish schools, married amongst each other or amongst regular Jewish families, you know, tremendous amount of attachment to the community. And nevertheless, though, they are having tremendous advantages and they are displacing a lot of the traditional elites as a result. So there's this huge upswell of resentment against these conversos specifically, which has its economic roots, and it also has, you know, kind of roots in religious antipathy because, hey, look at this. They're supposed to become Christians and they're still retaining their Jewish identity. This is not fair. And when you look around at people of authority, even in the church, and say, that one's a Jew and that one's a Jew and so on, it's a very kind of, you know, disconcerning feeling. So the church asserts itself, and not without the interest of Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand, who are you know, thinking different thoughts about the Jews than their predecessors. Whereas kings and queens typically protected Jews against the church quite often, as we've discussed in the past, that rule does not apply when there is a strong need for short-term gain. Isabella and Ferdinand had been engaged in very expensive wars in the south of the country in particular, trying to push the Muslims out. And the prospect of, you know, trying to get a one-time big surge of cash out of the Jewish population was quite appealing. So one of the ways in which this was expressed was they received from Pope Sixtus IV the permission to establish the Inquisition in Spain. This was in the year 1478. The Inquisition was not directed at Jews per se, or Muslims for that matter. It was directed at false converts, meaning the conversos who were secretly harboring Jewish attitudes or behaviors and so on. And the purpose of the Inquisition was to try to root out these false converts and to you know, punish them appropriately, to act as a deterrent to other would-be converts. And incidentally, part of that punishment meant the confiscation of their wealth, which was definitely something that Isabella and Ferdinand were interested in. The Grand Inquisitor, Tomas de Torquemada, engaged in a brutal upending of Iberian society by creating this purge-like environment where, you know, a Christian neighbor would betray a Jewish neighbor, or actually a converso neighbor, to the Inquisition. The Inquisition would arrest the converso neighbor, subject him or her to terrible tortures, and demand that he divulge the name of other conversos who were also secretly Judaizing. And under the pain of torture, you know, this would happen, and they get a whole list of names. They go out and arrest those people and torture those people. And the whole purge environment rapidly spun out of control. In the space of a couple decades, it just got beyond imagination how deeply this penetrated, where churchmen were often accused of being secretly Judaizers and things like that. The Jewish community really was at a loss as to how to respond to this appropriately. Remember, the Jewish community per se was not attacked in this manner because they were not, you know, Christians. They had not been converted, and so therefore they were still allowed to practice Judaism. But they were viewed with a tremendous amount of suspicion, especially as to the degree that they have been, may have been aiding and abetting these conversos who were secretly studying Judaism, keeping kosher, and so on. In one notorious case, some conversos actually engaged in a conspiracy to murder an inquisitor, Pedro de Arbues, and this sparked a lot more popular resentment at the activity of the conversos and the Jews, as you can see in this very evocative painting of the murder and the saintly visage of the inquisitor himself. But it rapidly spun out of control, and it proved to be something that Isabella and Ferdinand could not keep a lid on, but they still were faced with tremendous debts that they had to attain, they had to deal with. So just some of the examples of the way in which the Inquisition looked. In previous classes, I've given a lot of examples of the torture devices they use, which are truly horrific, and I don't want to put them in this lecture, but if you're curious, you can go back and look at my Jews of Sfarad series and you can see them there. These are three examples of sanbenitos. They really were quite elaborate types of punishments, and they describe their little French language captions underneath, hidden in this image, but on the left is a converso who has been accused but is not yet found guilty of practicing Judaism. In the center, you see a Jew who or a converso who has been accused and then has been found innocent. So he has kind of like a beatific sort of gaze on his face. And on the right, of course, where you have this decoration of demons of hell and burning alive and things like that, you have a converso who has been accused and found guilty of practicing Jewish rituals, and he, of course, is full of tears because what happens at this point, the Inquisition itself doesn't actually murder the Jews. The Inquisition relaxes its authority over these people to the secular authorities, who then, being much more savage, of course, end up engaging in an auto da fe or a mass burning. And these mass burnings of Jews, of conversos, were conducted throughout Spain and even into the New World. Really dramatic, terrifying scenes that attracted huge mobs of people to watch these Jews being burned alive. It's an absolutely horrific kind of environment that gripped the entire peninsula for decades. Ultimately, though, it was an untenable model, and it failed to deliver that big one-time jolt of cash that Ferdinand and Isabella maintained they needed. So it all came down to a dramatic moment when Ferdinand and Isabella decided to simply expel all the Jews of Spain. Recall, the real purpose of the Inquisition was to root out the false conversions of these once Jews, now Catholics. And by the way, we're referring not only to the first generation, but the second, third, fourth generation, because it's 100 years now since the 1391 pogroms. And Torquemada, who in this remarkable piece of art by Emilio Sala is shown in the black robe, wildly gesticulating, Torquemada says the reason why he has been unsuccessful at bringing the Inquisition to a conclusion, that the more he looks, the more amazingly he finds more of these Judaizers, he says it's because you still allow Jews to live in Spain proper. And while they are still in Spain, they can still influence their erstwhile co-religionists. And so therefore, he argues, and Ferdinand and Isabella accepted, that all the Jews must be expelled from the Iberian Peninsula in order to maintain the goals of the Inquisition, which was to allow the conversos to become fully Christian. In this particular image, you can see the dramatic range of expressions in the courtiers' faces all on the left and on the right in particular. And with his back to us stands the majestic Don Isaac Abarbanel, the great leader of Portuguese Jewry, who then rose up to become the second highest financial official in Spain as well. And he argued bitterly for the retention of the Jewish right to remain in Spain. Ferdinand and Isabella were loath to see him go because he was so talented, but he refused to convert. Unlike, as it happens, the number one figure, the aged Abraham Senior, and his son, Rabbi Melamed, who son-in-law, who decided they would rather convert and remain in Spain than to flee with the rest of the Jews out of the peninsula. But ultimately, that brings us to 1492. We will, God willing, discuss the mechanics of the expulsion and specifically the horrible nature of the initial post-diaspora years for these Sephardic Jews when we return. But with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention and your endurance, and I look forward to speaking with you soon. Thanks very much.